Welcome to this video, Azure Cost Management, Setup, Organization and Tagging, Part B, Setting Up Azure Entity Hierarchies. My name is Terry Clancy. This is part two of a four-part video series. The series covers setting up Azure environments, Azure hierarchies, secure access and settings, and reporting by dimensions and tags. One of the most important considerations when setting up your Azure environment for success is how to set up your entity hierarchy. In this context, entities can either be billing entities or resource entities. Let's first look at billing entities. Billing entities are different depending on how you purchase Azure. For example, there are different billing entities for each of Enterprise Agreements or EAs, Microsoft Customer Agreements or MCAs, Pay-as-you-go, or PAYG, and for customers of cloud solution providers, or CSPs. Over time, each of these channels will be unified into the Microsoft Customer Agreement, or MCA channel, which supports all these purchasing scenarios. In this video, we will look at the billing entities for Enterprise Agreements and Microsoft Customer Agreements. The Enterprise Agreement or EA billing entities determine your invoice structure and your top-level groupings for costs. For Enterprise Agreement or EA customers, there is one billing account per EA and one invoice per billing account. Under the billing account, using the EA Enterprise portal, you can set up multiple departments. Each department will appear as a separate section in your invoice and can be grouped and filtered separately in Azure Cost Management. Each department can have multiple enrollment accounts, which determines the subscription owners and provides another level of granularity by which costs can be grouped and filtered separately in Azure Cost Management. The enrollment account is the lowest EA billing entity. Underneath that are the resource entities. First, subscriptions, and under those, resource groups. Now let's look at the Microsoft Customer Agreement entity hierarchy. Microsoft is improving the Azure purchase experience for all users by introducing the Microsoft Customer Agreement, or MCA, as the primary way to purchase Azure for all customers, including, over time, EA customers. It allows for pay-as-you-go purchasing with no upfront commitment. The Microsoft Customer Agreement is a simplified, fully digital, non-expiring contract that enables you to start using products and services faster and delivers enhanced billing and cost management capabilities. For MCA customers, there is one billing account per agreement. But unlike the EA case, with MCA, you can configure multiple billing profiles in the Azure portal, and each billing profile will be issued separate invoices, which can optionally be in different currencies. And each billing profile can be grouped and filtered separately in Azure Cost Management. Each billing profile can have multiple invoice sections, which will appear as a separate section in your invoice and can be grouped and filtered separately in Azure Cost Management. So, whether you are purchasing Azure through EA or MCA, you should use billing entities to define the main high-level groupings by which you want to group costs and see them appear on your invoice. Above subscriptions, there is a separate resource entity hierarchy, which is separate and unrelated to the billing entities we have already discussed. This is the management group hierarchy. So, subscriptions exist in two largely unrelated hierarchies. This can be confusing for some people. Because they are independent of billing entities, management groups can span or include subscriptions from different PAYG, CSP, EA, and MCA accounts. They can also be helpful for historical reporting because within a management group scope, history is maintained through EA renewals or the transition from one purchasing channel, such as EA, to another, such as CSP or MCA. Azure resources and resource entities such as management groups are not impacted by changes in how you purchase Azure. The limitation of management groups is that they cannot span Azure AD directories. So you should define one root management group per AD directory. You can build a flexible structure of management groups and subscriptions to organize your resources into a hierarchy. The primary role of management groups is for unified policy and access management. This way, permissions, policies, resources can be assigned appropriately at, for example, a management group level, and so they then cascade down to the child management groups, subscriptions, resource groups, and resources. The management group hierarchy should be more focused on how you run Azure and on operational requirements. However, if possible, the structure should also allow costs to be scoped and rolled up in a useful way. For example, if cost centers are a useful demarcation for assigning RBAC roles in policies, as well as being useful for the aggregation of costs, then you're lucky and you should strongly consider using them as nodes in the hierarchy. Note that currently in Azure Cost Management, you can set the scope for Azure Cost Management to a management group, but you cannot group by or filter by management groups. If costs need to be aggregated in ways that do not align with any of the resource or billing entities, then as discussed in Part A of this video series, tags can be used to aggregate costs in multiple different ways. Now, let's look at best practices for organizing hierarchies. Across both billing and resource entity hierarchies, there are some common organizational patterns that may be useful. The business unit pattern groups subscriptions and accounts based on profit and loss category, business unit, division, or profit center. For organizations with global operations, the geographic pattern groups subscriptions and accounts based on geographic regions. The functional pattern organizes subscriptions and accounts along functional lines such as finance, sales, or IT. But note, however, that this approach can be susceptible to corporate reorganizations. Depending on the size and scale of an application and organization, it may be appropriate to separate applications by workload, application, or subscription. As an organization grows, other application categories often emerge that form logical boundaries for subscriptions. For example, applications that are mission critical, apps that are part of costs of goods sold or COGS for a company, apps that are subject to regulatory requirements such as HIPAA or FedRAMP. In general, these are good categories because they would each require different policies and RBAC assignments. Finally, it is generally a good idea to keep your production data, apps, and other assets out of your dev test environments. They should at least be in different subscriptions. Management group hierarchies can be up to 6 levels deep, not including the root, and 10,000 management groups can be supported in a single directory. This provides you with the flexibility to create a hierarchy that combines several of the organizational patterns to meet your organizational needs. For example, this diagram shows an organizational hierarchy that combines the business unit pattern, the geographic pattern, the environment pattern, the application category pattern, and the workload separation pattern. But beware, this is probably more complexity than you need. You should design a hierarchy that provides the scaffolding you need to grow, but without unnecessary complexity. Think in terms of the minimum viable product, or MVP, to provide the framework you need for the foreseeable future without too much complexity. This brings me to the end of Azure Cost Management, Setup, Organization, and Tagging, Part B, Setting Up Azure Entity Hierarchies. All the best with Azure Cost Management.